Mr. Barefoot.
he is great at it.
All right, Paul Evans.
All right. You know, Thomas back there was saying I look taller on camera. And even on stage, I probably look taller than I really am. Phil, come up here just a second, Phil. I don't know how tall Phil is. We're going to give you the good relationship here of what you're dealing with. Come on up, brother. Stand tall and proud.
It's not about the height.
It's not about the height. It's not about being super educated, though you got to be smart enough to put a handful of things together. You don't have to be tall. You don't have to know math. You can be medicated, and some of you should be, so that's good as well. You know, when it comes to business, we're often looking for those success strategies, those things that everybody has in common, those things that say, okay, if you fall in this pattern, you're sure to be a success. But everybody that I know who is ultra successful are really just being themselves. They're allowing themselves, giving themselves permission to be who they really are. And you've got to tap into that and be aware of that. As Paul mentioned early on, you see the way that David set up his business. It's aligned with what he believes success is for his own life. And most of us aren't very aware. We look out and we say, okay, that's who I want to be like. I love their business, so I like that number, and that's what I want to do. Instead, say, this is who I am. This is the way I act. This is the way I behave. And go with that. There's nothing wrong with it as long as it does not endanger another human being. You know, I was the kid in school that always got in trouble. I was always in the principal's office. I was always trying to be, quote, funny in class and paid for it. Because back in the day, I mean, they could paddle you. You know, I was asking somebody at school last week, I said, you know, do you guys paddle anymore? They said, no, we're not allowed to. I said, that's what shaped my entire life. Because I got paddled at school, paddled at home. I mean, I was bloody from the time I was 3. Until about the age of 22, because I think even in college, corporal punishment was still on the move. You know, nowadays, anybody gets to do just about anything, and sometimes we need the shaping of just a little bit of discipline to force us ahead. Now, we mentioned earlier about school teachers, and the school teachers don't even make .3. My wife is a school teacher. I remember the first time that I saw her check, I wasn't paying any attention to it. I saw it. I said, wow, baby, you know, is this your check? She said, yeah. I said, is this like for the week? And she said, no, it's for the month. I said, well, who in the world negotiated your pay? This is ridiculous. I said, why don't you just keep this? Just keep your check. You can spend it any way you want to because it's embarrassing. And so when she calls me one day, she says, Paul, I want you to come up to the school. I want you to deposit my check. I said, right, your check. Yeah, I'll come up and get that thing that you're calling a check, and I will take that to the bank. She said, we've got lunch from 11:30. To 11:50. I said, no problem, I will be there. And I'm usually an early person. I rarely run late, but that day there was an accident. I pulled into the school about 11:31. My phone rings. I say, hello. She says, baby, where are you? I said, I'm in the parking lot. She said, lunch is from 11:30 to 11:50. I said, yes, ma'am, I'm on the way in. We go in, we eat lunch, and it's about 11:48. And I get up, and she said, where are you going? I said, we're going to the office. We're going to pick your check up. We're going to deposit that. She said, lunch is from 11:30 to 11:50. Did you hear a bell? I said, no, I didn't. I didn't hear a bell. She said, oh, I'm sorry. Around here, we're on what's called a schedule. I said, I don't want to hear any more about that. I'm disturbed about it. My whole life, I've not fit in the schedule. I've never been able to hold down a job because of the stinking schedule. Why people have to clock in and clock out? I was going, this makes no sense to me. Why can't we work when we feel like it? Why can't we be motivated when we feel like it? And there were a couple of times in my life where I had that high level of structure, and that really drove me to say, all right, I've got to do things a little bit differently. I've got to go a little bit more in line with my personal wiring. And it took me a little bit of time, but I was able to find a way to be able to do that. Because we're all shaped by different things, by different circumstances, by different ideals, by different value systems, and by different priorities in our life. And we all get shaped by life itself. Back in 1986, I met my wife, met her at a gym. She was working out, and I was training her. It's coming up on February the 14th, and as Carrie mentioned, I've never been super social. I'm a lot more social up here than I am one-on-one. And so it was a girl that I really wanted to go out with, and I was thinking, wow, that'd be super cool, but I'm not going to ask her out because, you know, every guy's super scared of rejection, and I'm spotting her on the leg extension one day. She said, what are you doing for Valentine's Day? I said, you know, probably, you know, nothing. Nothing. She said, well, I've got this guy that asked me out, but he's like a real dork. Would you go out with me? I'm like, sure, I'd love to take his place. So here I was, just slipping right in. We ended up going out, hit it off. We dated for 4 years, and then we got married. And then once we got married, I thought, wow, this is just so awesome. This is perfect. This is everything that you ever dream of. At that time, I'd opened up a gym. Nobody told me that when you open a business, you were responsible for everything. I thought, wow, I'm going to get to go and work out all day, every day. This is pretty awesome. And then the rent was due, and then the employees, get this, they wanted to be paid. So all of that became a struggle. But me and Sherry, our life just continued to grow. And a couple of years after that, we decided, you know what, we need to start a family. As if you don't have kids, you're not a family, but you are. Well, we said, we're going to start a family. This will be pretty cool. And why did we do that? It's kind of like the gym. I didn't know what I was doing. I thought, wow, you know, we'll have a child. This will be great. So she gets pregnant, and during the whole course of the pregnancy, and you go to the Lamaze class, and there's always one lady in there that's had 18 children. She loves it. Birthing is easy as breathing. Everybody else in class is like, we hate you. Could you get a private tutor? You already know what you're doing. Why are you even coming in here? This is super aggravating. And so we ended up making it through Lamaze, but the last trimester is incredibly rough. In fact, right at the beginning of about the 7th month, we went in for an ultrasound, and the doctor said, all of the amniotic fluid around your child is pretty much gone. So the sac has totally engulfed your baby, and chances are he is going to have some struggles mentally. He's going to be handicapped, and we wanted to warn you ahead of time about that. And the hospital that we were with at the time said, we're not able to handle this level of situation. We need to send you up to Birmingham, to UAB, and make sure that you're taken care of. And so we went up there for about a week, and we came home. And the whole time, if anybody who's been through something like this, you know how you do. You're calling people, and you're asking them to pray, and you're saying, you know, please, we just want our child to be all right. We want our child to be healthy. And anybody who's a parent has probably prayed that prayer. We want our child to be healthy. But all the way up to that birth date, we were concerned. We were concerned about the health of our child. We were concerned about how we were going to deal with the mental difficulties. We didn't know if we were prepared for that. We didn't know how we were going to be able to handle that. We didn't know how we would react to that, because our minds in life almost totally prepare for perfection. It's the reason we get off track, because when we visualize what we want, we visualize perfection. We don't think, I'm going to start an online business. I can't wait to not be able to have my domain name and my FTP not connect. We don't think that. We think, wow, this works. We think, I'm going to start a blog. Wow, I didn't realize that once my blog was set up and I logged in for the first time, there was going to be a lot of language that I didn't understand. There were going to be a lot of buttons that I was afraid to push. And who knows what's going to happen. I didn't realize, because we don't dream in imperfection. We dream in perfection. And so we were dreaming about this perfect life. And now suddenly we're picking up books, how to raise a mentally challenged child or handicapped child. What do you do with the diet? What do you do with the learning? Are there special schools? So we're reading all of this. And we go to the hospital on March 27th, 1993. And when we get to the hospital, they say, we're going to have to induce you because your child's not coming naturally. And when they did and the contractions started, Samuel's heartbeat went from 150 to 60 and stayed at 60 for several minutes until it would begin to climb again. And the nurse came in and said, we're sorry, but your child is in duress. And we already knew that there were going to be many mental challenges. Our child is in duress. They said, what's happened is that the umbilical cord is wrapped around his neck. And with every contraction, it's contracting the umbilical cord. And it's choking Sam. And like everybody does, we pray. They say, you know, you've got to do an emergency C-section. When they say emergency, they don't mean like we're going to go get ready. They're rolling you in the process. And I still remember this. And this is a little bit graphic, but I still remember the anesthesia not totally taking effect. So when they took the knife, I still remember Sherry's cry. And minutes later, Samuel B. Evans entered the world. And they said, "You have a healthy baby boy." We said, "You know, healthy? Well, now, wait a minute. We were told." They said, "No, your baby boy is 100% healthy. There'll be no mental challenges. There'll be no physical challenges. We don't understand how this happened. He's totally healthy. And a couple of days later, we go home from the hospital, overjoyed. All of the nursery is set up. Now, we've read the books. We know that, you know, your first year, I don't know if you've seen this book, the first year, you know, we're on like page 57. All right, first thing you do when you get home, because, you know, raising a kid is nothing more than the great experiment. I mean, you don't know what's really going to happen. So we get home, we're like any other parents. We don't really understand this whole miracle of birth, and we're just laying around just thinking, wow, this is so awesome. We're parents, and everything is normal. May 4th, 1993. Stay home on that Tuesday from work because Sherry doesn't feel real well. I'm sitting on the couch and I'm holding Sam, and she goes and gets in the bathtub and she comes out and she puts her feet in my lap. I said, "How are you feeling?" She said, "I don't feel too good." We had a doctor's appointment at 1 o'clock. At 11:01, her body began to convulse. Her eyes peeled in the back of her head. I noticed that her stomach was moving as her body sucked in oxygen, but it didn't go into her lungs. It went into her stomach. I said, "Sherry, wake up, baby. Wake up. You're having a bad dream. You're having a nightmare." No response. I said, "Wake up, baby. Wake up. You're having a nightmare." No response. And for the first time in my life, I picked up the receiver, and I punched in 911, and within minutes, the ambulance was there. We didn't live far at all from the hospital. And they took Sherry's body, and I'd been performing CPR. I'd had all the classes from owning the gym. And they put her on the stretcher, and a nurse whose name I don't remember, but whose voice I can still hear, when I said, "Is she breathing?" And she said, not on her own. A friend drove me right behind the ambulance to the hospital. And we get there and we're in a waiting room. And as any of you know that's been in a hospital waiting room, it's ill-prepared to receive any kind of news, whether it's good news or whether it's bad news. But we dream with perfection. And so I began to imagine what was going to be said. I began to imagine the words of the doctor as the doctor would come out and let us know the good news of how everything is going to be all right. And Dr. Hayes comes out, says, "Mr. Evans, would you tell me about the morning?" And I did, detail for detail. And I knew that was good news because he wanted to know about the details of the day. And I waited for him to say, "Mr. Evans, your wife is in critical but stable condition. Everything's going to be okay." But instead, I heard, "I'm sorry, Mr. Evans, but your wife has passed away." Oh, what happened to the dream? What happened to the ideal? What happened to the perfection? Just a few hours before, we were at home, and it was just like a television show where everything goes right. And hours later, everything's upside down. Everything changes because it's life. And so out of this life, what do I do? Well, how do I go forward? How do I make changes? And the real lesson of all of that was really priority. The real lesson about life was to say what really counts and what really matters. And this is one of my priorities that you'll hear a lot about this weekend. This is 100X Missions. You see, the young boy in blue, he's from India. Over here to the right is Malawi. Below right is Peru. In the middle is Mexico. To the left is Zimbabwe. Priorities, because things change and because things shift. Priority of time, of what really matters, of what really counts, of how we begin to measure things differently because of circumstances in our life. To say, you know what, the things that I really thought were important, the things that really mattered, the things that really counted, suddenly they've taken on a whole new significance. And even though I felt like I was miswired and misaligned with normal society, it was really death that brought to me life. It was really death that realigned everything and says, this is what really matters, whether it's kids or whether it's my kids, to say, I want to control time. I want to have freedom. I want to do business on my own terms. Now, just because I dreamed that did not mean it was going to happen easily. It didn't mean that there weren't going to be some hiccups. Sometimes when we stand up and say, all right, I made this decision. I was going to control my time. I was going to take life back. And from that moment on, everything went perfect. It didn't. It's hard. It's hard to build a business. It's hard to move forward. But when you make the decision based on a priority, it begins to filter everything else in your life. And so my filter came in place. So that I said, the business that I build, regardless of what it is, it's going to allow me to control my time. It's going to allow me to not miss anything with my family. And it's going to allow me to give to orphans. So those were my values that I really wanted to hold on to. And anything that moved outside of that was crossed off the list. Oh, that's not going to help me give back to orphans. I'm not doing that. Oh, that's going to take time away from my family when he has this production that he's in and I'm going to miss it. So I'm just not going to be able to go. Because it now becomes a filter. And that's how we begin to align ourselves with priorities. What's this got to do with speaking, right? Well, speaking is about priorities. It's about knowing your message. It's about knowing what you're going to share and why you are going to share it. So here's my family, top left, Alabama, which side is which? Top left, here we are in Rome. Middle top is Stephen a few years ago when we were in Rome doing some kind of gang symbol. I'm still nervous about that. Don't know where he learned it from. But I was like, boy, gang symbols and pink shirts, it doesn't work well. We gotta strengthen your stance on that. Sam is in top right with Martin in Cozumel. Bottom right is Marla. We're in Peru. And in the middle is a construction job we were on. And there's Stephen a little bit older in the yellow shirt. And then bottom left, Marla and I in Peru. So that I've been blessed for the family to continue, and that Marla is the only mom that Sam has ever known. And we've been blessed to be able to take our priorities, and at times when we didn't have that much money, to say this is our priority. This is what we do without. This is how we go forward. And so with speaking, you begin by centering and saying this is what's important. These are things that I don't compromise in my message. These are things that I don't compromise when I share. So that when I share, I'm not going to say anything that makes you think I'm not dedicated to my family. That's one of my filters. I'm not going to do anything that makes you think that time is not precious to me. It's very precious. I'll give you a tool to use in just a moment, a mental cue. And I'm not going to do anything that takes away from giving from orphans for those who really are innocent and did nothing to be in the position that they're in. But those are my values on the screen. Those are the things that measure almost every aspect of my life, and governing all of that, as you can probably guess, is faith. Because time and our message are critical for us to share. Because in this room today, say there's 150 people, I'm not sure exactly. But as I share with you, I'm not speaking to 150 people. I was reminded of this morning from Chris Luksha. He said, you said this a while back, and I still remember it. And I thought, I need to remember to share that again, is that I'm not speaking to 150 people. But if I speak for an hour, I'm speaking to 150 man hours. I've taken 150 hours that could have been used for something else and decided to dominate it with time and words and hope that your 1 hour in this place is more valuable than your 1 hour somewhere else. to teach you something, to challenge you with something that's going to make this 1 hour 150 hours worth of value, and not just 1 hour. And I want you to think about that with your message. If there's a secret to speaking, it's to understand that the only thing that we really have in life is time and the influence of that time on other human beings. And so not to say, well, whatever I say or whatever I share or whatever I speak, I'm going to be casual about it, but instead to say I'm going to be intentional with it. I want to say something that is going to impact a life, that is going to help a life, that is going to direct a life. As I listened to Paul this morning and listened to David this morning, I went and going, man, and those guys could speak. I'm just a southern boy. I don't even know what I'm going to do up there. I was thinking, I love hearing that because my hours this morning were not wasted. I grew from that. And there was probably no other place that on this day I needed to be than to be challenged to dream bigger or to be challenged to understand business better. Because the more I can be challenged, the more I grow, the more I know, the more I'm able to shape lives, and the more orphans I'm able to help, the better I can raise my kids, the better husband I can be to my wife, and the more people in general, hopefully, will help the world become a better place. Life is short, not just physically for some of us, but life is short. It's too short to eat oatmeal. It's just a sidebar. Not too short for Five Guys. Amen. So what's the key to influence? What's the key to impact? What is the key to wealth? It's speaking. Now, I don't even mean on a platform, but it's words. Words are not going away. We think in words. We share with words. A while ago, I said, Phil, come up here. Phil came up here. I didn't just stare at Phil like, you know, I would have, even if I could project thought, he would have had to hear my thoughts and come up. Words are not leaving. They are the catalyst of business. They are the catalyst of influence. They are the catalyst of impact. We tell people things, believe it or not, and they do it, unless you've got kids, and that's just a crapshoot. But for the most part, we tell people things, they act. This morning, I'm watching you guys. You're writing things down. Why? Somebody spoke, you wrote it down. For those of you who are believers, you know at the very beginning it says, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and God said, he spoke words and something happened. If you're even more familiar, you may be familiar with John 1, when it says that the word became flesh. May not be as familiar with this, but it's one of the scariest passages to me in all of the Bible. It's when the Israelites came out of Israel, and they go into the foreign land to spy it out, and it was never said, go find out what the people are like. It just said, go and see what's going on. It didn't say, go over and check out if you can take them or not. He said, I've already given you the land. Just go check it out and report back. What was supposed to happen is they were supposed to go in and see the size of the produce, and see how many herds were there, and then we're supposed to get excited and go, we cannot wait to take that place over. It is loaded. Instead, they came back, and they said, those people are giants. I said, I hear you. Those people are giants. We are grasshoppers in our own eyes. We cannot go up against them. We will be defeated. Then over in Numbers 14, I know y'all didn't come to hear a sermon today, but this is so powerful. The Lord said, I will do to you the very things I heard you say. What? I will do to you the very things I heard you say. In other words, our words are powerful. The way we speak to ourselves is powerful. The words we speak to other people are powerful. So speaking is the catalyst of almost every single one of our businesses. What are key words? Key words. There they are. It's everywhere. Your content on your blog, it's words. You may be going, I don't speak. Yeah, you do. How many of you got a blog? All right. You are a public speaker. How many of you are on Twitter? You are a public tweeter, I guess. How many of you are on Facebook? All right, y'all. We are all public speakers. It's something about the platform that people go, I'm scared to death getting in front of people. No, you're not. You send stupid stuff on Facebook all the time. People might think I'm dumb. They do. They do. I've read your post. They are dumb. Absolutely. Don't let that hold you back. I mean, if being dumb is going to hold any of us back, well, we're not going to do anything. See, we're so scared about what other people think. Another huge rule of public speaking. Don't be worried about that. Don't worry about what other people think. A general rule in speaking, general, is the 2-96-2 rule. That people who get on a stage, that 2% will think that that's the best speaker I've ever heard. 2% will think that is the absolute worst speaker I've ever heard. Shoot for the 96% because those bookends, they're just not normal. You've got to, even the people that love you, they're a little bit kooky. And the people that hate you, well, they're just deranged. So stay away from them altogether. But most people who speak, most people who write, worry about the one negative instead of the 100 positives. When you share your message, don't worry about the critics. Critics never share anything to help you. They share it only to help themselves. I remember speaking somewhere one time and gave some feedback about what, you know, speakers like to hear and don't like to hear. This was actually in a Bible setting, a preacher setting. I said, preachers really hate it when you come up to them afterwards and say, you know, that was a great point, but you could have said. You know, preachers just don't like that. You could have said. Well, I'm not a preacher, so I mentioned that to a guy. I actually mentioned it to a crowd. And after it was over, this guy came up and said, that was a really interesting talk. But here's something I think you might want to add to that. He said, what? Excuse me. I said, what? He said, I wanted to share something with you. I said, nope. And the guy who had hired me was standing next to me. And he's like, Paul, that's rude. I said, it is. What are you going to do about him? He said, I think you need to listen to him. I said, he didn't listen to me. I don't think I will. And I walked off. Now, you're not going to believe this. They didn't rehire me after that. It's bizarre situation. And I'm not saying be like that. That's some of my bad wiring. What I am saying is that we can't be so focused on the one that we forget about serving the masses. Let's not be scared. Let's share the message. Well, Paul, the first time I get up and speak or the first time I write, it ain't going to be perfect. Well, don't worry. The 1,000th time, it won't be perfect either. That's all right. Just put it out there. Listen, there are plenty of people out there on the internet who will be more than willing to correct you. Do you know that you missed that comma? If I knew what a comma was, I would know that I missed it. You know, send me the free editing and help a brother out. You know, that's the way I live my life. I know everybody else can't live it that way, but be thinking about your message is much more important to be shared openly and receive correction than not to share it at all. Let it remain inside of you and never change a life. You've got to let your message out, not be scared to do that. So whether you're blogging or whether you're tweeting or Facebooking or whatever the medium is, you are a public speaker, period. It's not optional. It's going to happen. Northwestern Mutual Financial Network, they were the ones who handled the beneficiary policy after Sherry died. They did a great job. When you're young, and even when you're old, the first time you go through the situation of a funeral, you don't know any of those details. You don't understand it. You don't know what's going on. You don't know why it's going on. So we enter into the funeral home. I didn't know what we were supposed to do. And we get in there, and the funeral home director says, Mr. Evans, your life insurance agent, Ken Azar, has already called ahead. He has assured us that all of the financial responsibilities will easily be able to be covered by you because of your policy. He's also let us know that we are not to show you anything out of the norm and that we are not to pressure you in any way, or he will pay us a visit. And I thought, I love my insurance dude. I remember thinking, I love Ken. Because, I mean, really, Ken, he's a Southern guy, but he'll go New York on you if he needs to. And I was thinking, man, he had called up the funeral home and threatened them. That's the way you serve people. I thought, this is awesome. So after Sherry's death and we had the funeral, I was speaking a lot at churches and sharing the story and really sharing about what do you do after a loss? How do you move on from that? How do you go forward? And so around that, a few months later, or quite a bit later, I guess, somebody was talking with me, and I said, yeah, you know, I'm ready to date any time. I'm not a big believer in how long do you figure out, you let the memory, how long do you honor the memory? I've never figured that out. And I knew Sherry wouldn't be worried about anything like that. I knew that there were people out there on the planet that were very concerned that I was Sam's dad alone. I mean, they knew me well enough to say, that's not safe. That child is going to end up messed up. If he wasn't brain damaged at birth, it could happen simply by being in his care. And so I was talking to one of my friends, said, yeah, I need to go out with somebody. And he said, well, you know, I know this girl. And his wife was Sherry's best friend, said, you are not going out with any of those girls. They're just a bunch of hillbillies. They're nasty. And you're not going out with them. I was like, all right, I see that there's going to be some sort of interview process that comes along with it. And she said, Marla Graves, that's the only girl that you're allowed to go out with. Now, what do you think about that? People running your life. Have any of you people got people running your life? That's the only girl you can go out with. So he called her and said, Marla, I got somebody I want you to go out with. She said, who is it? Paul Evans. No, I don't think so. I said, do you know him? Yeah, I don't think so. I said, wow. wow, confidence builder. That's why I never asked girls out when I was a teenager. Rejection, and I didn't even ask. Had somebody asking for me. She said, well, why not? She goes, well, I just dated this guy. He got his ankle hurt in intramural sports, and he had to go home to his mama for 6 weeks. And this guy's lost his wife. There's no telling what kind of condition he's in. I just don't have time to put up with anybody high maintenance. And I heard that, and I thought, this is the girl for me, because we were in alignment. So she happened to be somewhere that I was speaking after that and came up afterwards and gave Connie the note that said, hey, get him to call me. And so because of speaking, I met my spouse. So you never know the words that you're out there sharing. So as I began to speak, I thought, okay, well, this message is impacting. And I was really thinking in my mind, how do I move from pain to profit, pain to profit? And I began writing down all the places that I could take my message. And this is an exercise that you need to do. You need to write down all the places that you can take your message, whether it's on a blog or whether it's speaking publicly. And I began to write down who in the world could benefit from what I've gone through. And so I began to measure all of this. Well, you know, obviously, since I was already doing it, I was speaking to what? To churches. Now, I don't know if y'all know about this, but churches are not big time on the pay scale. At times, they will call themselves cheap. Now, they will put in a $500,000 multimedia facility. You know, they'll put up the screens, the video, and everything. But you're coming in with a life-changing message? Yeah, we can probably pay you about $100 for that. Wow, I probably can't come. There you go. So I thought, churches, this isn't going to work. And I'm a church kid. I just knew this isn't going to work. They're not going to end up liking my message. I'm a little bit forceful at times and direct. So then I began to make another list. I thought I could go into hospitals because the hospital that I'd been in, the service after the death was awful. I remember going in and seeing Sherry's body, and the nurse said, you the husband? I said, yes. You better get those rings off of her before they disappear. I'll be waiting outside. And that was it. I thought, wow, you are amazing. And so then I thought maybe I could talk to, you know, nurses about loss and those kind of things. And then I thought of my Northwestern Mutual dude, Ken. And this is a little bit different, and this is not the traditional road to speaking. Like, I've never had a speaker video, speaker audio. I've done a ton of speaking in life, and I've never been hired because somebody saw the video or I sent out a package. I've had plenty of people call and say, hey, send me your speaker package. I said, that is great. I'm going to lead off with that one at your event because I do not have a speaker's package. And so I called Ken. I said, Ken, I'm going to start doing speaking to insurance agents and insurance businesses. He said, you are? I said, yeah. And you're in charge of booking me. He said, what? I said, you're in charge of booking me. Now, here's what I want. I don't want to start with Northwestern. I said, are there any meetings in the state that have multiple agencies represented? And he said, yeah, there's one in Montgomery. It has about 200 different agencies there. I said, that's the one I want to go to. I'm going to speak free at that one, and I'm going to charge after that. He said, well, how are you going to do that? I said, because I'm going to go in, I'm going to tell this story, and after it's over, there are going to be people that come up and say, we want you to come to our office and share that story. And I'm going to say, that's awesome. I can't wait to come and share my story with you. What's your budget? And so that was my entire speaker plan. And it worked amazingly well. Ken got me booked. I went in, told the story, gave them 3 points of how they could change the relationship with the market ages of 20 to 30. And so at the next event, I went in, and it was actually Northwestern. I went in and spoke for 20 minutes. Now, this is how sharp I am on setting my fee. It was over. He said, "Oh, we forgot to set up your fee." I said, "We sure did." He said, "Well, what do you usually get paid?" I said, "That's just embarrassing to even share with you because I didn't have a fee." So therefore, if I just said it was embarrassing, what would that mean to the guy? He wouldn't think it was $50. He would think it was way higher than that, right? At least that's the way I was thinking. You know, I was like, it's just embarrassing. I tell you what might be best is if you just go back and you think about it and you look at your budget and you just send me a check for what you think it was worth. All right? So I was thinking, now I'm about 25 years old at the time, and you know, 10 bucks, that's a huge amount of money to me. And on my way out, they'd given me this medallion. And I remember praying on the way to the car, "Lord, please don't let this medallion be my payment." Because I knew it wasn't worth anything, because like the guy next to me got one too. So about 2 days later, I get a check in the mail for $1,500. And I thought, 20 minutes, I drove down the road, it was $1,500 to talk for 20 minutes. This sounds like something I can do. I think I can do this. So the next guy calls me, "Paul, we want you to come speak to our group. Can you do that?" I said, "I can. What's your fee?" I said, "Well, I can't tell you my exact fee, but I will let you know that Northwestern gave me $1,500 for 20 minutes. Now, I know you're competitors, and certainly you'd like to rise above the fray of Northwestern." So, I mean, no plan. It's weird. So what's the lesson? Be a little bit weird, and it can work to your advantage. If you're thinking, "Paul, that's not normal," you're dead on. Now, let me get you to raise your hand. How many of you here today think, or have thought at times, "I'm not normal"? Look at this. Look at this. Go forward and prosper. I mean, this is the key catalyst. If there's one thing we've all got in common, it's that we are not normal. If you're waiting on normal to arrive before you begin to speak or before you begin to make money, you will always be broke. So go forward and be weird. It's all right. Back in 1986, I worked at a gym. I was a personal trainer. And back in that day, you didn't have to be certified. It didn't really matter. Nobody checked out if anybody was exercising correctly or not. And if you got injured, well, guess what? It was your fault. Nowadays, you got to have insurance. Everybody's got to learn perfect form. It's just a weird time that we live in. And so I was training people back at that time, and I would get to work out about 4 o'clock after I trained some other people. And they always said, if you go into the free weight room, and that's like stuff like this, like dumbbells and barbells, it wasn't machines. And of course, I'm a personal trainer. I don't use those machines. I'm using the barbells and dumbbells. So I'm in there, and I'm working out, and I'm training. And they said, you've always got to have a spotter. You got to have somebody that's in there that will spot you in case you get trapped under the weight, which was a great idea for some other people. But I am a personal trainer. I know what I'm doing. So I get down, lay down on the bench press. Most of you know what this exercise is. You lay on your back, you unrack the weight, you bring it down to your chest, you push it up. This was light day, 135, pumped out about 20 reps with that, no big deal. Slapped on a couple of quarters on there, 175, went and did that a little bit, slapped on some more, got up 205, did that. Got up to 225, decided, you know, I'd do some sets of five sets of five on that day. 225, I weighed all of 155, you know, and so, and at my height, you know, there's not much distance. So there was, you know, no big real pain in doing that. So I unrack it, and I'm down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and I'm all alone up here in the free weight room, all by myself, and I'm thinking, I can do another one. And I bring it down, and I push it up. Man, I am strong today. I can catch another one. I bring it down, I push it up, and I'm thinking, I've got one more. Now, here's the deal. If you think you got one more, you ain't got one more. If you're thinking, I got one more, you ain't got it. So I bring it down, and with all of the strength of like a seventh grade girl, I'm just, yeah. I mean, they can't bench 225. I'm not busting on chicks, but I mean, seriously, if there's a seventh grade girl that can bench 225, something ain't right. She could be from Alabama. We just eat raw meat right off the cow. So I'm stuck. Now I'm thinking. I'm thinking that we're in a situation. Now I've got a couple of options. Option number one is to die. So I'm not excited about that option. So I'm a quick thinker. I cross that one off. So I'm not going to do that one. Option number two was to yell for help. But I couldn't do that because I was a personal trainer and a man. And men don't yell for help, so I knew that I wasn't going to be yelling for any help. Now, the third option was I'd broken another rule. You're supposed to put the collars on the end of the barbells. And I didn't put the collars on. Well, I had two 45-pound plates on each side. I'm on the second floor. Right underneath me is a ladies' aerobics class. Because I'm smart, I know that sound travels. I know that when I lean to the right and that 90 pounds hits that floor, and then gravity is going to take over the other 90, and it's going to slap the other floor. And I'm thinking, I've got probably about 6.3 seconds to reload that bar so when those ladies come up, I can be sitting on the bench going, heard nothing. Heard nobody up here but the personal trainer. Y'all heard something down there. Huh. So I was getting ready to make my move. I was just about ready to lean to the right. And right when I was getting ready, a pair of hands appeared, reached down, grabbed the bar, yanked it off of me, and re-racked. Her name was Trisha. It was a bad day. She wasn't in seventh grade, but it was a bad day for personal trainers and men alike. So in our closing time, I want to take the weight off of you when it comes to communication. I want to take a little weight off of you when it comes to public speaking, to sharing your thoughts and any fear that you might have about that. This is the University of Alabama football stadium. Thought you might want to see it. Also known as the Temple in Alabama. When you speak, there are three things. We've got three lists of threes. When you speak, number one, think about this. What do I want people to think? What do I want people to think? We're using words. We are controlling thought. We are controlling thought. Now, it doesn't mean that there won't be random thought. It doesn't mean that when I tell a story, somebody's mind doesn't go off somewhere else. It does. But for the most part, we are controlling thought. So number one, what do I want under power? What do I want people to think? Number two, what do I want people to feel. What do you feel when you see that picture? Listen to that. And the guys didn't do anything. The ladies are like, oh, the guys are like, I ain't doing it, but I feel it. I'm not going to make that sound. When I told you the story about Sherry's death, the energy in the room was sadness. You know, I can feel that energy. I feel your energy. As a speaker, we can't hide our energy. It's impossible. So I felt your sadness. Not everybody's, but most people were very sad when they heard that. Saw a lot of tear wiping. When I just told the story, her name was Trisha. I knew ahead of time how you would feel. You would laugh. You're thinking, this guy's a loser. So I knew ahead of time the feelings. I controlled with two stories how you felt. Not wrongly, not manipulation, but it's what we do as human beings. We do it across the board. Most of the time we do it not in a positive way. Like, we want to hurt someone, we can't hurt someone. I mean, the dumbest phrase ever. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will. I mean, crazy. Words crush us. Words crush our spirit. As Paul spoke about this morning, hearing, you're stupid. You hear that long enough over and over and over again. Well, the same thing's true in our businesses. When we speak, there's a power in not only understanding what I want people to think, what do I want people to feel, and then what do I want people to do? What do I want people to do? Here's Superman lifting up somebody's cars. You know, power, and that is a power that we have when we speak or when we write or when we share. When you tweet, hey, go check out this article on, what do people do? They click. You've spoken publicly and they've moved. Or if you have a product and you've got a few on your list and you say, hey, I just released a new product, go check it out and buy it. Click here. They click and they buy. That's why when we talk about sales, we tell you to tell people what to do. Don't just think that they're going to go, I need to buy that. They might. But if you tell them, buy this now. And if you use any scarcity, the first 10 get, or this closes down at noon. It's influence, it's impact through the use of words in which you told somebody what to do. Now, this is how we sell with speaking. We control what they're thinking, they're processing for either the sales page or through the live event. We control how they feel. Now, again, not in a negative way. We control their feelings through the process, through the sales copy, through the live event. And then at the bottom, we tell them what to do. I've told a lot of stories, and now I've gotten to the point where you're starting to write things down. You've had thoughts. You've had feelings. You're doing. You're living out this presentation right now in this room, and people listen. They live out this presentation every time you tell them to do something. Or every time you tell the story on your blog, or you think it's not even important that you shared that little Johnny, for the first time ever, got a hit at baseball practice. And you're thinking, this is so corny, nobody cares about this. And you've been blogging about important stuff. You've been blogging about how to change the world through recycling. And you've just been like, man, you need to start recycling. And you're like, nobody's commenting. And they all know how important recycling is. Rid the world of plastic. And not a comment, just crickets. Little Johnny today got his first hit. Oh, we're so proud of little Johnny. It's so amazing. You're such a good mom. You're such a good dad. What? What? Why? Because you made them think something, and you made them feel something, and you made them do something because of a relationship. When we speak, we're not just making people think or feel or do absent of a relationship. That's where our influence is. It's in the relationship. I love this event. I love Carrie. I love Eddie. I love the other speakers. I love you guys that I get to work with so closely. Well, it makes a big, big difference. Lives really are changed. And I don't say that as some like motivational deal and say, you know, you change lives. You could make a list of lives that you've literally changed. Most of you don't because you think, I don't really make a difference. But you really do. I mean, if there's an exercise you ought to do tonight, you ought to sit down and think of just one person in your business, one person in your life that you forever changed their course. And that's not arrogant. It's just real. It's to say, I do make a difference with my words, with the way that I speak. Now, principles, three speaking principles. And we need to integrate this in almost everything. It doesn't have to be in everything. And there's going to be different levels according to our personality types. Over there on the left, we need to educate. We need to educate. E equals MC squared. And you know what that means? Something. It means something. I don't know what. But this cat here spent a lot of time talking about that, and a lot of other cats listened to it. And there's been big books published on it, and people were educated and smarter because of it. I just am not actually in that crowd. So we want to educate. When we speak, we want to educate. We want to share something with people so that they learn. So there's learning that takes place. It doesn't mean that everything has to be new. It may simply be a reminder. I don't think I've shared anything earth-shattering, but maybe there's been some aha. Okay, wow, my story can really make a difference. They didn't go, you know what, Paul Evans said that my story makes a difference. First time I ever heard that. But maybe, just maybe for the first time, you believed it and you were reminded of it. So that's education. Secondly, he's actually writing up on the board. You may not be able to read it. It says, I will use Google before asking dumb questions. And just write that down. Well, you can, if you're coaching people, send that picture to them. Now, I wouldn't do that because I'm very sensitive. So that's equipping. So there's educating, there's equipping. And these points you've heard 1,000 times, I want you to go forth and do them. You want to educate people, you want to equip them. You want to show them how to do this. I didn't just get up and say, you need to speak, you need to speak, you need to speak, you need to speak, go speak. I said, here's how you speak. Control the thought, control the heart, you control the hands. Head, heart, hands. You come in, you educate people. When you share with them, you equip them. You give them ways to carry out your instructions. You don't just say, go ride a bike. You say, here is how to ride the bike. You equip. And then finally, bottom right picture, you entertain. You entertain. And this is one of the hardest for most people, is to be entertaining. You know, I can stand up here and we can laugh a little bit and we can have a good time. We can share some stories. But you know, when you're doing that on camera outside of a group, I'm a group person. If I hear laughter, what's that tell me? It must have been funny or it was sympathy. It was one of those two. But I'm in the ballpark. But when you're on camera and there's nobody out there, you don't know if you're just being funny or being weird. And you don't know if people go, wow, I like that guy's got a personality. Or they're like, wow, with a video camera and a little spare time, people will abuse the system. So you never know exactly what's going on. So, you know, live is easy to do. So I know entertainment is not easy. So how do we entertain safely without telling jokes or without trying to be funny? We share life. We share life. We share what happened at the grocery store. Because everybody's pulled off the wrong can and it all came falling to the ground. It's not knockdown funny. It's just a funny experience. We've all been daydreaming or on the phone or something at a red light when we weren't supposed to, and it turned green and somebody behind us beeps and we get aggravated and we, you know, we stay there longer. And so I sat at the light another 5 minutes tweeting and letting them know they weren't getting around me. Not that y'all would do that, but that's something you tweet about and you share, and it's funny because it's just a like experience. Common ground. The way that we entertain is through common ground. We've all got weird Uncle Jeff or the grandmother that just doesn't care what anybody else thinks on the planet. My grandfather was being honored at an event, and for some reason she thought that the guy at the event was cutting my grandfather down. And she's on stage. There's 1,000 people out there in the audience. And they say something negative about my grandfather. And she's sitting on stage and she goes, hush up. Hush up. Well, that's not knockdown funny, but it's kind of like, I got a grandmama like that. I got the grandmama that's a little bit strange, a little bit different. We'll always say the inappropriate comment or is super sarcastic. And so we share it through common ground. And the last three, when we speak from our purpose, our reason. You know, my purpose in life, and I don't think that we've got one purpose. I think we've got several purposes personally. I think that some of us may decide to choose a purpose, and that's cool. Some of us may feel like we got assigned a purpose, and that's cool. And some of us may just go out there and just go, you know what, I'm just going to have to bust it. This is my purpose that I'm going to own, and we are going to pursue it. And that's cool as well. I don't think any one of those are more right or wrong than another. Often we feel like, well, I'm waiting for the big revelation so I know exactly what my purpose is. Well, who knows what your purpose is? It may be that for today, you've got a specific purpose that doesn't exist 2 weeks from now. And there's nothing wrong with that. But in the moment, be true to who you are. In the moment, when you begin to speak, you've got an overall purpose of a message that you're sharing. And when I say speak, it can be on the platform. It could be your article. So your purpose is basically your article title. Three ways to read this article and stay awake at the same time. You know, that may be actually what you're beginning to write about. So there's your purpose. So after you state your purpose, you state your points. I mean, this is a simple public speaking outline. I'm not sharing anything here that's revolutionary. But I guarantee you, if you make speaking complex, it's going to annihilate you. Instead, make it super simple. You know, three ways to read this article and stay awake at the same time. Way number one, keep your eyes open. Keep your eyes open. You know, we're sharing deep things from the stage today. So keep your eyes open is point number one. And you begin listing your points down the page. And every point goes back to your purpose. Yeah, not rocket science. Every point goes back to your purpose so that it simply strengthens the entire idea that you said at the very beginning. So everything comes back, everything comes back, everything comes back. And then finally, you just offer some proof. Why should I believe you? If you use a statistic, obviously everybody believes that. If you tell a story of stuff that happens in your life, people believe that. For the most part, even though we say we live in a skeptical society, and we do when they come to our website and we're asking them to buy something, but in general, if you tell a story, people believe it's true. It's proof, it's evidence. We use testimonials. We share what happened in somebody else's life. And this is all really part of being able to speak. Speaking's not hard. What we're scared of is maybe being embarrassed or what other people think, but it's not tough. I mean, here's how easy it is. Most of us have been speaking since we were one or two. How many of you have done that? All right, a lot of evidence. Some of y'all still, you know, struggling with that. They're like, I can talk, but I can't get my hand up. You know, we are challenged by thinking this is difficult. We've talked our whole life. And get this, we even have people that come up to us and say, this being our family maybe, what do you think about X? And what do? Do we go, I'd love to share that with you. Not a public speaker. Find someone else. Nope. Even if we don't have any business sharing it, we share. Oh, and we share. One of my favorites is somebody that's like going through a marriage problem, and they'll ask somebody that's been like divorced 9 times, I'm struggling in my marriage, what should I do? And that person, 9 times, well, let me tell you what you need to do, honey. What you need to shut up. But no, they will talk. Why? Because they've been asked their advice. Listen, we got a lot of people out there talking, don't need to be talking. They need to shut up. You need to get your voice out there in their place. Maybe people be listening to you over them. And it's super simple. Your purpose, your points, and your proof. But who am I to? Who am I to do this? Who am I to say this? Why me? I don't know. Why not you? We all got a list of why we shouldn't be doing stuff. We're not going to spend any time on that because I think that's just kind of dumb. I think it's really just kind of dumb. If you're breathing, you're valid. All right? If you've studied something in your niche that other people don't know about, just go ahead and share that, all right? I loved what Paul said this morning. And just write this. Just live this. I mean, how hard? I read, I write, I speak, I study, I teach. It's information marketing. It's information publishing. It's what we do. I need to come up with something original. Or read 10 books and give people your thoughts. I mean, it's not rocket science. I loved when he shared that. I said, that's my new lifestyle. I've got to cut back even more, and I barely do anything now. Paul, what do you do? I don't know. I'm just hoping something shows up. Just this morning, I met many of you that came up and say, Paul, I've been on your webinars. Paul, I've been part of your teleconferences. Paul, when you and Carrie did this, I watched people going up to Carrie. Carrie, I want you to know, how did all this happen? Did it happen because we sat behind our computers silently, hoping someone might stop by and help us to get our PDF online? It's because we're loudmouths. It's because we've got strong opinions. But you change it through being vocal. You need to speak. You need to share your message. You need to talk. You've been talking all your life. I'm willing to talk. Here's Jose. He's from Mexico. I sponsor him. His dad was 80 years old. His mom was a mentally challenged 23-year-old lady. His dad passed away. And his mom obviously could not care for him. So he entered into the orphan system of Mexico. And here's the deal, is he can't be adopted because one of his parents is still alive, but he can't return to the parent. So he is labeled unadoptable. Our Mexico mission focuses on the unadoptable. Jose is in a family unit with a mom and with a dad on a campus, where he has 8 other brothers and sisters in his home. And he smiles like that all the time. So it's one of my motivators. It's one of the reasons I talk. Maybe you need a Jose. Maybe it's your kid. Maybe it's something that happened to someone in your family. But we all need a reason not to shut up. We all need a reason to share our message. We all need to be talking and sharing how our lives have been changed. You know, with my life, I want to help people make more so they can give more, so they can live more. Because life keeps going. The clock, it keeps ticking. It's not slowing down. It's no respecter of persons. The longer you stay silent, the less lives are changed. Because we got to put as much into life as we can. We got to pour into others as much life as we can. Because life, it's like the speech. When it's over, it's over. Be blessed.